Good evening, everybody. Welcome to Columbia, Columbia's Graduate School of Journalism. I'm Steve Call. I'm the Dean of the Journalism School, and I'm delighted to be here again this year to celebrate the outstanding environmental reporting from the past year with the 2018 John B. Oakes Awards. This award is given annually to reporting that makes an exceptional contribution to the public's understanding of environmental issues. And the award program has been with us for a good while now. It was founded in 1993, and it honors the memory of John Bertram Oakes, who was the influential editorial writer and editor at the New York Times. He was known for his fierce intellect and his passion for our field, and he was a pioneer of environmental journalism, and he's sometimes credited as the originator of the contemporary op-ed page at the Times. And I'd like to welcome two of his children here tonight, Andra and John Oakes, and some of their family. Thank you for joining us and for your role in this form of thought leadership that we're very proud to have here at Columbia. And I'd like to also especially welcome the members of the Oakes jury who are here tonight. That includes John, but also Amelia Ascari, Talia Buford, Jody Callender, Suzanne Rust. And John, would you please stand and be acknowledged? Thank you. All of you. Suzanne, where are you? Okay. I really appreciate your time and commitment to these awards. I know that how seriously you take the decision-making, and it does require a lot of care. Welcome, of course, to our honorees tonight from the New York Times, the Post and Courier, and Quartz. I think this is another year that makes us aware of how important and difficult the kind of accountability journalism that's required off of the main institutions sometimes in the agencies or in the field. This is a time where we're all aware of the critical role that journalism must play to hold powerful people and institutions accountable. And environmental reporting is in some ways traditional, as we'll see, I think, in the Times series, that they really went after the heart of power, even though those institutions were closed, difficult to penetrate. They were making critical decisions in secret, and the Times brought those decisions to public light and really forced the public to engage with the consequences of their government's action. So I think of that as classic accountability investigative reporting. But we have in the two extraordinary finalists other forms of revelation that are particularly difficult in this newsroom environment where jobs are changing, being restructured, newsrooms are sometimes shrinking. And I fear sometimes that the environmental beat is one of the first to suffer when these changes occur. And so I'm particularly glad to honor some unconventional and creative and original reporting away from the corridors of power tonight. So the three bodies of work that we'll be honoring and hearing from the authors about, first, as I mentioned, the deeply reported series by the team of reporters at the Times who detailed the Trump administration's efforts to roll back environmental protections and those who stood to benefit from these policy changes in the private sector. We'll hear about a data-driven report on toxic algae blooms, one of those less visible but critically important environmental crises that often goes unchronicled in this country. The work of the Courier Journal actually led to the government developing a way to track this problem that is entirely new. And finally, we have a less familiar but powerful global report looking for a rigorous way to describe a solution to climate change and to examine the promise and the limitations of carbon capture technology, which, if it were to succeed, would be absolutely vital in the efforts to contain global warming. And the author, who we'll hear from later, went to 12 countries to really look for promise and the limitations of this central technology that is really rarely on the front pages of our papers. So to tonight's winners, it's my pleasure to hand out the prizes and the checks up here over a while. As I invite you forward, I just want to note that there's an X in front of the podium, and when and I've been instructed to stand on that X for the benefit of our photographer. So if you see me shuffling, that's why we're trying to move into that position. Agenda is we hand out the prizes, which is the fun part, and then Amelia Ascari has agreed to moderate a panel where all of the reporters and authors will have a chance to talk a little bit about their work and take questions from you. So first to the two finalists. The first finalist, as I mentioned, goes to probably the best named body of work of the three, Scum. Toxic algae is a growing menace. And I have to say that my wonderful colleagues in the prizes department wrote me some notes for these remarks and suggested that I say that this was a piece of work that dived into the scum. But I would prefer to say that it explored the problem of scum to provide readers of the Post and Courier an informative and colorful series of stories documenting this important threat. The author, Tony Bartlemy, is an investigative reporter who's been a Pulitzer finalist many times. And the Post and Courier in the Carolinas is just an exemplary institution, winner of the Public Service Award within the last few years, and really kind of a national treasure that you worry about a lot in this age of disruption and restructuring in the news business. But I'm very glad to honor Tony's work tonight. So please join me in congratulating Tony for Scum, Toxic Algae. Our second finalist tonight goes to The Race to Zero Emissions, a series from Quartz, a news website that covers trends in the global economy. This is an expansive reporting project that covered 12 countries, cutting through the noise to explore whether carbon capture is capable of meeting the ambitious targets outlined by the Paris Accord. Often, climate change reporting is justifiably alarming, but this series, led by journalist Akshat Rati, offers something quite different, a solutions-oriented approach. The project takes a clear-eyed assessment of the fast-advancing technology of carbon capture, presenting it not as an easy out, but as an essential element of any comprehensive plan that's going to attempt to meet the emissions targets that we require in any reasonable forecast over the next decades. With clear explanatory writing and outstanding informational graphics, the series has become a definitive piece that many other journalists turn to and cite. The fact that Akshat has a PhD in chemistry may explain some of the success of this work and also makes you very unusual here in the journalism school building. So congratulations, Akshat, and please come accept your award as well. And now to our winners. I'd like to celebrate Trump Rules, a historic drive to roll back environmental protections, which was the series title given to the New York Times outstanding investigative and accountability reporting about the Trump administration's environmental policies that unfurled over a number of weeks. And I was struck by, for those of us who still read the Dead Tree edition, how often the quality of this work led, or the leadership of the Times and its support for this work led these stories to be positioned in the top right corner, even though they were enterprise stories. They were always unfolding on a Monday morning or a Sunday morning in the lead news position. It was a kind of testament to the depth and urgency of this commitment, but also the recognition that this kind of reporting is as vital to our role as journalists as more traditional Washington reporting. So the Times and its reporters, Eric Lipton, Coral Davenport, Hiroko Tabuchi, Danielle Ivory, and Barry Meyer, showed extraordinary skill and perseverance in documenting a historic shift in environmental policy and industry's hand in that transformation. They fought for release of tens of thousands of records, combed the regulatory fine print, and assembled a database that revealed a precipitous drop in enforcement in the first year of the Trump administration. The team went to great lengths to document the consequences with eyewitness reports from Wyoming's gas fields, Montana's coal mines, and the Midwest's smokestack communities. They also annotated and shared many of the important source documents that they had wrested free, making Trump rules not just a piece of important investigative reporting, but also an archive that other researchers and writers will return to in the years ahead. So to give you a taste of what went into this series of stories, we have an excerpt from that Showtime documentary, The Fourth Estate, in which our friend Mr. Lipton makes a cameo appearance. Can we roll the videotape?
Regulations that go from Wall Street to the environment to gun control and health care. Trump has completely turned them over in a matter of months. And it's playing out right now in a really intense way. So I proposed a series of stories on this topic. This is Eric. Yeah, I can. Hey, Dean. I mean, the agencies are already suspending implementation of dozens of regulations. Yeah. And it's happening, you know, at the SEC, at the EPA, at the Interior. I mean, they're across the government, stuff is just being stopped.
Eric is relentless. I think he's won 3 Pulitzers now. You know, he's a machine.
I mean, I have so many stories and so many topics. Everything is in its own folder, or else I'd completely lose it.
He had a story about Trump's businesses in India. All of a sudden, he emailed me at home on Saturday at 10 p.m. to say, I need somebody to edit the story right away. So I sat there in my kitchen and edited the story on my laptop. And then he said, well, the story is going to be updated at 3 a.m. Who is going to be around to edit it? And I said, not me, you know? Eric, I'm going to bed.
Eric was telling me we worked together briefly at the Washington Post, and then when he went to the Times, he was reminding me he went to cover City Hall first, and Elizabeth was the bureau chief, and he was in the number 2 seat. So that easy affection was born of camaraderie on the front lines of the late Giuliani administration. Anyway. To all of you, all 5 of you, congratulations on this important work, and please come and enjoy our applause as you accept your awards. Thank you. Okay, and now to our panel, I'd like to invite Amelia to the stage and all of the authors. You might as well also just join her. I think there's an indication on each chair as to where everybody's supposed to sit. Yeah? Thank you. Thank you, Amelia, for doing it.
Thank you, Dean. Terrific. Thank you very much, Dean Call. And I say challenge accepted. Just a moment ago, you said you were running the fun part of the evening tonight. Well, I think that we will have a very fun and interesting discussion here as well. Although, of course, handing out the prize is a very special moment, and I want to take this moment to congratulate all of you personally. Great work. And I echo your thoughts, Dean Call, about the real importance of this work at this moment in time. The theme that runs through all 3 of these stories that we're talking about tonight is public accountability of the government. And I think there's never been a more important time for journalists to play that key role in our democracy. And as I met the members of the Oaks family who are here tonight and spoke briefly with them, I thought, what a powerful legacy they have created for John Bertram Oaks to honor and elevate attention for these this great work at this important time. So in that spirit, let's begin our conversation. I'd like to turn to Coral and Eric first and ask you a little bit about how you began this investigation. What was the process? I think your work is very powerful, and the depth is daunting. So can you tell us a little bit about that process?
I can start. The first story in the series came about, Eric and I worked on it together, and it came about at the moment when Trump announced that he was going to withdraw the United States from the Paris Climate Agreement. And Eric and I, at that time, we'd been working on a story for a while that we were sort of looking for a home for. And soon, right after that, Elizabeth Buehmiller, who our editor, who you just saw in the clip, called us in and said, "Can you do a story that tells us how the Republican Party got to this moment? How it got to a moment where not just that it's withdrawing the United States from this global accord, but to the point where the president is comfortable saying, representing his party and saying, climate change isn't real, and it's our policy to roll back all these regulations." And part of the reason that we felt the need to tell this story, and the lead of the first story that we wrote in the series, was a look at the 2008 presidential campaign at the Republican nominee. The nominee of the Republican Party was running on his environmental credentials. John McCain was running on the fact that he had stronger environmental credentials than Barack Obama. And it was true. John McCain had sponsored cap and trade legislation. John McCain was running on addressing climate change as a national security issue. This was who the Republicans had nominated as their standard bearer, and how in less than 10 years this had kind of turned around. And it really was, you know, we at this moment we were sort of accepting, like, oh, well, this is what Republicans do, but it wasn't to be expected. It was sort of a shocking turnaround, and it had a lot to do with you know, with the Citizens United decision and the way in which money can influence the political process, and how that changed as a result of the Supreme Court decision. And Eric sort of stepped in and said, you know, did a great piece of that story, you know, just looking deeply at sort of how this dark money came in and how industry was able to play a much bigger role than it ever had in influencing the policy and the politics of this. And that's kind of what got us started, in answer to, like, wait a minute, how did we get here? This is not necessarily a given that we were going to be here, but so we wanted to kind of answer that question.
Yeah, I would just add that as a reporter that was covering lobbying in the Obama administration, and I would move around various industry sectors, and I wrote about how kind of, you know, third-party groups and were using their powers to try to get things done that they wanted to get done. And as a, you know, D.C.-based reporter, all of us were surprised at the outcome of what had happened. But the thing that was most startling to me at the beginning of the Trump administration was watching all these people that I had written about as lobbyists suddenly become part of the administration. And so Mike Cantazaro moved into the White House as the top environmental and energy advisor. Nancy Beck went from the American Chemistry Council into the EPA to be the top chemistry and toxics advisor. And, you know, the guy at Homeland Security that was overseeing TSA and the purchasing of all kinds of equipment having to do with security had just left as the chief lobbyist for the company that was selling the equipment that was going to be at the checkpoints. And across the administration, I was observing this incredible transformation of the regulated becoming the regulators. And I thought, we can't just write about all these people who are switching jobs. We have to understand how they have put down their folders in their offices as lobbyists and then moved over to the agencies in which they were lobbying. And within a matter of days, literally, were in charge of regulating the same industries that they were trying to change the policies of. And we had to understand that story, not just, you know, the breaking news out of it, but the backstories. And so we, you know, Dean Murphy, who's here in this room, became my boss, and we created a team of reporters that Danielle Ivory here is a part of, and Barry Meyer was a part of, and we decided that the New York Times had sufficient capacity to really tell that story in a narrative way. And that's where these stories came from, was to tell the backstory of how Nancy Beck took over chemical, you know, toxics policy at the EPA and then helped rewrite the rules that were going to determine what represents a toxic chemical in the United States for the next several decades. And Bill Wareham, another story that we did recently, who's in charge of air policy at the EPA, you know, put down his files as the top, you know, lawyer for all of the coal-burning power plants and then became the top regulator overseeing coal-burning power plants in the United States. And it's an incredible transformation that has implications that are going to last for decades, and much beyond the Mueller investigation. And the New York Times was willing to support that work, and Jesse Pesta edited many of these stories along with Dean Murphy. And one brief thing that Steve Call mentioned, he was noticing that so many of the stories got great play on Sundays and Mondays. He didn't realize that Dean Murphy has a dual role at the New York Times. He's also the weekend editor. And he controls the Sunday and Monday papers. And so he put those stories in those great spots. And thank you so much, Dean, for both editing many of these stories and then giving them great play. So I'll stop at that.
That's some interesting insight. Of course. of course, you know that supporters of the Trump administration would say that this kind of churn happens with every change in administration. I'm not asking you to defend what you just said, but I'm offering you the chance to respond to that criticism that is likely to come from people who might hear our conversation in the future.
I just think that the extreme of the pendulum swing, I mean, Coral, you know, defer to you as well, is just that is beyond, you'd have to, if anything, you'd have to compare it to the Reagan administration, I would think. I mean, and sometimes I wonder when we write these stories, it's like, who's the constituency, you know, with like the glider trucks, the super polluting glider trucks, which Pruitt decided to give a loophole to allow them to increase the number of trucks that could be manufactured. It's like, well, who's the constituency there? There's a small number of manufacturers of these glider trucks that don't have modern emissions controls, and he wanted to give an exception to, and he gave the exception to, and then ultimately, you know, the court overturned it, and now Wheeler has backed away from it. But it's hard for me to understand the who's the constituency. And so I just think that the extent of the shift is beyond anything we've seen since at least the Reagan administration. So Coral.
And I would argue that some of this is coming from the top, quite specifically from the president. Some of the shift.
Hold the microphone up higher.
Here?
Yeah.
Okay. Some of what is so remarkable here, again, comes directly from the president. You know, we started out with this story about how the politics had changed so much. There's this idea that, well, Republicans have always sort of been against regulation, and haven't Republicans denied the science of climate change before? Well, no Republican president has ever done so. George W. Bush didn't. you know, we haven't seen this level of a kind of denying of basic established on the ground scientific facts. That's new. The level at which basic science is ignored or even mocked within the White House or within agencies like the EPA that are based on scientific research. These regulations, these decisions, these regulators have what they're supposed to do is supposed to be based on scientific research. And we have not seen this level of dismissal of science. That's new, remarkable, and distinctive. The other thing is, you know, we see from the top, from this president, this sort of ideological drive to roll back regulations that when it is executed, we have seen, you know, for example, in rolling the glider track regulation or some of these other regulatory rollbacks, when Eric asked, where's the constituency? Something that's really remarkable is that in some cases, the regulatory rollbacks have not even been what the regulated industries have asked for. We have seen this with rollbacks of emissions on tailpipe pollution from cars. You know, the auto companies have said, well, wait a minute, the way that you're doing this could potentially be even more complicated for us. This strange ideological drive to roll back regulations, potentially, possibly even at the economic expense of the regulated industries, just to get those regulations off the books, is something that is remarkable and distinctive, and we have not seen in other Republican administrations. And again, I would speak to Eric's point. You're absolutely right that there is a churn, sort of yes, you know, people from industry, especially in Republican administrations, will come in and will oversee, and we saw that in the Bush administration, and a lot of the regulators now in the Trump administration have just kind of gone through a double revolving door. They were lobbyists during the Obama administration, and they were regulators during the Bush administration. But I do think that we see it to a much more sort of stunningly crystalline degree. Like the revolving door is so much more extreme. And again, it's happening in administration that made an explicit claim, you know, no lobbyists, we're cleaning out the swamp, we don't want these Washington insiders. That's exactly who they got. So all of these factors together combine to make this a very startling and shocking landscape in terms of rolling back these regulations.
Certainly, it's an extraordinary time to be a journalist in Washington, especially covering the EPA. I think that, and especially for the New York Times, because you are frequently mentioned. You, like your company, and sometimes you personally are frequently mentioned as not doing a good job. Could you speak a little bit about the kind of the personal effort that has gone into covering these issues over the last couple of years since the 2016 election, and how that may be different from the tenor of your work before the election?
There's no question that particularly the first year was an incredibly intense period and required just work that just never seemed to end. But at the same time, we all sensed how important it was, and the changes in the federal government were so, you know, immense and fast, and the resources that the New York Times was willing to put to it to allow us to cover it was so generous. And wherever the story took us, and however long it took us, the paper was willing to fund it. And I mean, Dean Baquet, the executive editor, you know, when he was actually still in the Washington Bureau, used to tell me that, you know, to Eric, just buy a one-way ticket. You know, he's like, you don't know how long it's going to take, you know, and that it didn't matter. It's just like, just go, you know, and I don't even often sometimes tell my bosses where I'm going. I just go, you know, and whatever it costs and however long it takes, it's just that those are the stories that I follow. And it's an incredible thing to work for a news organization that has the confidence in its reporters and the resources to back them up, and knowing that its readers, you know, really want those stories that are deeply told deeply reported. And I've been, I mean, just in the last couple of weeks, I've been to Montana and Wyoming and Houston and for stories. And I just go. And you know, I haven't even filed my, I'm behind on my expense reports. My wife is like, just file the expense report. It's like mm-hmm. the worst part of my job is filing that expense report. Is there anyone here from the New York Times could tell you? But it's because the resources are there to allow us to tell that story. And that's an incredible privilege. It's also an incredible burden because as a reporter, I have this seat, and we all have these seats at the Times that that you feel you have to take the most advantage of, and you can't waste even a minute because you have this power and resources behind you that you have to exploit. And if you don't take full advantage of it, then you are burning a resource that is so rare and privileged that you're wasting it. And so I feel that burden, and it drives me to work even harder.
There's another answer to that question. You asked about sort of a personal element. And one of the things that happens as a New York Times reporter is that you are under exceptional scrutiny, not just your work, but personally. And soon after Scott Pruitt became administrator of the EPA, Eric and I worked together on a story detailing specifically the unprecedented levels of secrecy within the EPA. And I sent... And so when you're doing a story about secrecy within a government agency, it's very hard to get people to tell you things. You know, they were like, this is an agency where people are intentionally trying to conceal things. And the career staffers, I kept hearing all these rumors about all this stuff that was happening, that, you know, Pruitt had double schedules and, you know, that career staffers were being told they couldn't write anything down. And, you know, people were having their phones confiscated. You know, this is when we were starting to hear about the security booth, but none of it could be verified and no one would put anything in writing and everyone was terrified. So I sent an email to a leader of the EPA employees union. And I said, look, I'm hearing all these rumors. I can't report this in rumor form. I understand that people are afraid for their jobs. And I sort of detailed different ways that, you know, can people talk to me in this way? If I can get five people and I know who they are to tell me the same story, I can just write about that. I can describe this without having to use anyone's name or quote anyone. And these are the kinds of rumors I'm hearing. This is compelling, interesting stuff, but I can't report it in rumor form. You know, could you please send this out to employees to see if anyone has experienced this, has been told to suppress information, or, you know, just trying to get information. So I sent this email, and he told me, he's like, I'll forward this out to a bunch of employees and we'll see what we can get. So a few days later, it's a Saturday, and I'm working in a cafe, and I get a phone call from another publication saying, hey, I have this email that you sent to a bunch that got sent around the EPA, and I'm preparing to write a story about it. Do you want to respond? So I called my editor, and my editor talked to the reporter, and that publication ended up deciding, okay, no, this is just an example of a reporter doing their job, and we're not going to do a story about it. The publication that did end up doing a story was Breitbart. And so they published the email, and they also published the email addresses of all the employees that my email was sent to. So, you know, essentially exposing letting anyone who wanted to know, these are potential people who might have leaked to me, who might have spoken to me. So my whole email was put out, and then Breitbart ended up like writing three stories about this, how this is an example of New York Times colluding and, you know, soliciting. And I was so grateful. I was like, you know, my editors knew that this was coming out. It came out. It got all over Twitter. Talked about it with my editors. We decided this is okay. This is, you know, the Washington Post ended up writing about it and saying sort of this is an example of a journalist doing their job. But just you have to know that that could happen with any email that you write, any exchange that you have. You know that you're, you know, I've been personally attacked. When I got married, which I did in 2016, there was a Trump administration source who wrote a horrible personal blog post about my wedding announcement in the Times. My husband works for the Energy Department, and they broke down all these details showing how he must have been a secret source for me. And it's fine. He's not. But it's, you know, it was very, when I found that, it's very, you know, you just know you're under personal scrutiny all the time. Your emails are going to be published. Your wedding announcement is going to be smeared, you know, by a Trump transition advisor who is also a source. So we just know we have to be really, really, really careful, and that we are going to be targets, and we can't, you know, the slightest little screw up is going to be amplified. So we just always have to be very, very aware of that.
Thank you. So I want to just take a quick moment and ask, are there any Columbia students in the room tonight? Terrific. So heads up that in a little while, I'm going to be opening up the mic for questions from the floor. And we're going to have the first couple questions from Columbia students. So be thinking. And now I'd like to turn to Tony, because obviously the New York Times has extraordinary resources and has done an extraordinary work on this topic. You also have done extraordinary work at a national level, creating national databases at the Post and Courier. So tell us a little bit about how you got started on your story.
So a doctor friend of mine once said that every conversation is a chance to learn and save somebody's life. And just like a doctor, every conversation you have with anybody can be a story. And so Scum began with a conversation with an admiral who said, Tony, there's this federal lab in South Carolina that is, it's the only one of its kind in the maybe the world, that searches for toxins in toxic algae blooms. And I had no idea about toxic algae blooms. I knew nothing about the subject, but I had a conversation with the lab director. And so we start talking about harmful algae blooms, and he's, you know, I was fascinated by his search for things that are unknown. So he looks for needles in the haystack without knowing what the needles look like. And so the more I learned about it, the more fascinated I got. And then I started digging around, kind of searching for a simple answer to the question, how many algae blooms are out there in the United States? And I couldn't find an answer. So I thought, well, why don't I try to do it myself? And so I built this database, kind of cobbling together a bunch of databases from various states that do keep track of harmful algae blooms. Then I combined that with some web scraping, really simple Google News alerts, and then put it all together. And I found out that there were the year before, there were 500 algae blooms, harmful algae blooms around the country, this huge problem that's kind of flying under the radar. And then a few days later, the CDC calls me after we published the story and says, so how did you do that? I told them, I said, it's pretty easy. And they said, oh, we're going to do it too. And then we thought of the name, you know, Scum, and then it was a done deal after that.
Talk a little bit about the impact of your story. I mean, the impact of the New York Times reporting, I think we've all noticed. But we might not have noticed the various outcomes that have flowed from your Scum work. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
my Scummy work has... I fully expected it was last year to come out during a major harmful algae bloom outbreak, and our timing would be such that it would gain national attention. And it wasn't as big a deal as it is this year, which is, it's a huge problem this year. So our timing was a little ahead of the game. It got national attention. We had lots of interest from around the country, and in terms of impact, you know, the federal agency started looking at it, but it also kind of got lost amid the Trump stuff too. So Yeah. Lost in the scum.
Okay, Akshat, you have taken almost a year to work on your very compelling pieces as well that also hold government accountable, but in a different way, not by so much looking at what they are doing, but what they haven't done, what they could be doing in relationship to climate change. Please tell us a little bit more about how you got started on your story and how you gathered resources and time to work on your pieces.
So this was about the time when Trump got elected. In his campaigns, he talked about clean coal a number of times, trying to appeal to his base. And nobody I spoke to within, you know, either the campaign side really understood what Trump was talking about. It wasn't clear Trump knew what he was talking about. There was a comment he made, I think, in one of the speeches where he said, you know, we take a piece of coal, we clean it, and then we use it, and that's clean coal. And I knew what the technology was. And it was the time when Elijah Wilson, who's my editor, we were thinking about doing something deeper, longer on energy and the environment. And he suggested, you know, come up with three ideas that we can pick at over a little bit of a time. And carbon capture was one of them. And so we knew that it'll be in the conversation through the Trump administration, given he's going to keep on talking about it. And so we put together a proposal to the City University of New York, where they have a business journalism, investigative journalism fellowship, and we were lucky to win that. And that allowed us to use that money for travel, and Quartz supported all the work that we put into the series. And the series really looked at what is carbon capture technology, where is it, whether it can be used to hit the emissions reductions goals that we have towards trying to mitigate climate change. Yeah.
So for somebody who is just maybe listening to this and isn't aware of what carbon capture means, can you give us a two-sentence explanation?
It's not clean coal. let's put that first. What it does is it's a simple technology that separates carbon dioxide from any fossil fuel burning emissions. And then you can do a bunch of things with that carbon dioxide. You could either bury it back underground where it came from, or you could put it to some sort of use that stops it going into the atmosphere. This could be either put it in cement or plastic. There is a company that makes fuels out of them. It'll go back into the atmosphere in that case after the fuel is burned, but for the period that it is a fuel, it stays outside the atmosphere. So that's basic. That's the technology, and you know, clean coal is being used as a marketing slogan. There are two power plants in the world, one in Canada and one in the US, that is a coal power plant that has a carbon capture unit attached to it. It cuts about 90% of emissions of the that are captured from the power plant. So it's not 100%. There are still some emissions that go out, but it does reduce carbon dioxide emissions. And given, you know, about 40% of all electricity even today around the world is generated by coal and will continue to be for some decades to come if we are to reach zero emissions, which is the goal that the Paris Climate Agreement has set up for us, we'll have to use this technology and at scale.
So for your stories, you traveled to six different countries and also reported in 12 countries. Can you tell us a little bit more about the challenges there?
So carbon capture technology, U.S. is the leader in deploying it. And so the U.S. was the focus to start with. But the most number of coal power plants right now are in China. And if this technology is to succeed, China has to play as key role in deploying it as the U.S. and other countries have to. So the challenge was really to try and understand what were the regional policies, energy policies, are very different in different countries. I live in London. It has a very different UK as a country has a different policy. Even though EU has some energy policies within the EU, each country has a different policy on how it treats emissions, how it treats carbon prices or puts a price on carbon in some form. And then China is a black box. As a reporter, getting a visa there is difficult. Once you get a visa, the companies that would use carbon capture technology tend to be power plants that have carbon dioxide to produce, but also oil companies, because they use the carbon dioxide to pump it into an oil field and extract more oil out, which might seem ironic, but it is overall better for the environment because the carbon dioxide does stay in the oil field. But in China, these oil companies are almost all state-owned, and getting into any one of them is really difficult. So it was, I remember I booked a ticket, not a one-way ticket, don't have the resources, did have a return, but I also had a visa that only allowed me to be in the country for 19 days, an odd number, I don't know why that was chosen. And I knocked on doors through sources to try and get me to oil companies to show me whether this thing that China thinks it will be using as a clean technology is real, whether that exists. After five oil companies, it was the sixth, it was 2 days before I had to go back, an oil company said, sure, come. And I was in Beijing, and I had to fly to Shandong, and the flight got canceled that morning. So we had to take a bus, and the translator was with me. And so we had to take a bus. So our morning appointments, which was it was supposed to be the whole day, we reached there at 1 p.m. It was probably like 40 degrees Celsius. But once we got there, and once the source understood what we were trying to achieve, he was very open. He took us to all the places that I wanted to see. And I was able to write the story. But, yeah.
So there are a lot of challenges involved with environmental journalism, for sure, in different ways in different places. So now is the time when I'm going to kick this open for discussion. And I'd like to ask any Columbia journalism student to stand and ask a question. Yes. Oh, sorry. Should have given you guys more of a heads up on that. Sorry.
Thank you. This question is for Tony. I was wondering how much experience you had with data before building your database, and if you didn't, how did you learn what to do?
So I have a fair amount of experience over the years building databases of pretty, they're not particularly sophisticated. So I've done a lot of database work, but this was a simple database that I did. It was basically a collection of anecdotes and incidents, and then I just put it all together in a big spreadsheet. So it was a very simple one. You don't have to master some foreign strange program to be able to do some pretty great work.
And just to emphasize, this was a national database that no one else in the government or anywhere else had collected. We having these algal blooms across the country, and their real health impacts. I was really moved by some of your reporting about how people were sickened and how property values were impacted, and people had to move because they were close to places that had persistent algal blooms, impacts for pets, lots of deep impacts from just a little bit of scum on the water. Yes, another Columbia journalism student. Yes.
Hello. So now we know that there are a lot of civil servants who work in the EPA and other government agencies who, have a problem implementing the policies that they're told to. So was that, first, was that advantage to your reporting? And second, after the Breitbart breach, how do you go about protecting your sources and convincing others to speak with you?
The Breitbart breach really hurt. So I've been covering environmental policy for about 10 years, and until the Trump administration, I found that the EPA was and other a CIA reporter once said to me, I think the EPA is harder than the CIA to crack. People just, you know, they're and federal employees, career staffers in general, are given, you know, seminars and sort of, you know, workplace training, like never, ever, 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 ever talk to reporters. And by and large, they follow it. You know, they want to do their jobs. They don't, they never want their name in the press. If they want something out there, they want it attached, you know, to a spokesperson, not to them. This administration has completely turned that upside down. Now I have a file titled EPA Employees Who Will Talk. And they're still scared, you know, but it started with the nomination of Scott Pruitt, even before he was confirmed. In my reporting, I was able to write a story about EPA career staffers across the country, because the EPA has regional offices all across the country, who were calling their senators and asking them to vote against confirming him. And I was able to, and I did the same thing. I said, look, if I can talk to, you know, five of you, and I can describe what's happening. I don't have to quote anyone. I don't have to name anyone. I ended up talking to maybe a dozen in that case, of people who said, you know, I'm a career employee. I've worked at the EPA for 20 years through multiple administrations. I haven't always loved, you know, what the administration is doing, but this is my job and my career. Who said, I feel like this guy is threatening not just the mission, but even the existence of this agency. He terrifies me. So from the beginning, and those people were so afraid, but I did the story. No one was named. I did cite some employees by state. There were some employees, I talked to multiple employees in the state of North Carolina. And I said, can I say, you know, because EPA has their lab headquarters is there. So a lot of sort of career scientists I talked to there. And so I had this story and I was able to kind of send it around. And I said, you know, send this story. I sent emails or I talked, or actually it's not even emails. It's now like Signal and WhatsApp and encrypted apps. Where I said, send this story. And then I kept doing others. I said, send these stories to your friends and colleagues so they can see this is how I do my job. I don't want to name people. I don't want anyone to get fired. I don't want anyone to lose their job. I do want to feel like I am accurately reporting on what career employees are saying and thinking. So they did. There was a dark period after that. After that email was published, I think there were like 30 names, full names and addresses, and people were petrified. They were like, you know, so I never use email. I use encrypted apps. I call people on their cell on weekends. I have people, career staffers at the EPA who I have phone calls with, have been having phone calls with on the weekends for months, who that what they've told me hasn't yet materialized into stories, but I think eventually it will. So I have to be patient. I have to, you know, I have people who've said, I want to tell you this, but you know, you can't tell my story until I've left the agency, which I'm going to do, you know, this year, or I might get fired. I have like a collection of anecdotes of people who say, if you publish this, I'll lose my job. But if I lose my job, then you can publish it. I have an awesome story waiting for that moment. None of this ever happened before the Trump administration. This is truly, I think, committed government workers who just had jobs that they believed in, who never would have done something like this, who just sort of feel fundamentally that the mission of the agency, that their livelihood is threatened, you know, they are motivated by they're more afraid by what they see happening than they are afraid by the consequences of talking to a reporter. And so that dynamic has really shifted. But it's always hard. I mean, I always have to talk for a long time and do a lot of handholding before people are willing to share.
Okay, we have another question over here. There's one right here.
Or you? Okay, go ahead.
Whoever has the mic.
Go ahead. Thank you guys for coming. I'm in the investigative reporting sector in particular, and this might be a tough question, but you were saying how the Admiral said that it can feel like looking for a needle in a haystack and you don't even know what the needle looks like. And I think that's kind of reporting in general or journalism. Sometimes you don't, you know, it's the Socratic paradox. How do you know that which you don't know? So I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about how you guys tend to find stories in the beginning, like how you have the whiff of a new story. Is it usually from asking sources, like, hey, what am I not looking at? Is it from data, a little bit of both? But I guess I'm wondering less about the process of unraveling and more how you find that initial story.
I just would offer something that's a little counterintuitive to what we've been talking about, which is that you often build hypotheses, but they're always subject to change, and you have to be willing to let them change based on what you're experiencing as a reporter. And so, for example, during the Obama administration, I went to go visit the American Farm Bureau to do a story about a rule called the Waters of the U.S., and I was convinced that the American Farm Bureau was a front for like the chemical industry and the golf courses and home builders that didn't want the Waters of the U.S. rule to be implemented during the Obama administration. And when I was interviewing the folks from the American Farm Bureau, I actually began to realize that the real story was a story about how the Sierra Club and the Obama administration had conspired to try to influence U.S. public opinion about the Waters of the U.S. and had actually done some things that appeared to be illegal in terms of their collaboration, and which actually represented a form of covert propaganda to try to elicit public comments that supported the rule in a way that influenced the outcome of the rule. And the people from the American Farm Bureau were able to sort of help me understand how the Obama administration had teamed up with the environmentalists in a way that was legal. And so I went in there thinking I was doing a story about the American Farm Bureau and its conspiracy with the golf courses and home builders, and I walked out determined to investigate a story about a collaboration between the environmentalists and the Obama administration. And I wrote that story, and it ran on the front page, and that ended up resulting in an investigation by the GAO, which concluded that, in fact, the Obama administration had violated a prohibition on covert propaganda. And there was another front page story when the GAO finally came out with that report. But I guess the point is that you have a hypothesis, but the hypothesis always has to be subject to change. And if you go into any story unwilling to modify the hypothesis, then you're not really an investigative reporter. You know, then you're an ideologue. And we don't want to be ideologues, and we want to be, you know, open to seeing what we see and allowing our story to modify based on that experience. And I'm right now we seem to be writing about how regulatory change and regulatory rollbacks are bad, but you know, we're writing about the power that has the power, and we're trying to deconstruct that power. But we're all equal opportunity reporters that are willing to, you know, to sort of challenge any authority. And whether it's aligned with the environmentalists or aligned with the regulated industries. And I think that's the key to investigative journalism, is to not allow your biases to determine what the story is, but to let the data in front of you sort of direct the story as it plays out. And I'd
add that it's nice to hear this from Eric. I'm like a baby investigative journalist. But this is exactly what I did, and I suppose I used some of my scientific training that you have a hypothesis, and then you try and either prove it correct or wrong. And so when I went into trying to cover carbon capture, it was a technology, not people, that I had a hypothesis about. I understood the science, but I was unsure whether, you know, once you put it under the ground, will it stay there? How does it stay there? The geology wasn't clear to me. I'd never studied that. And then I spoke to experts, and I came to know that there are actually just like you have natural gas fields, you actually have carbon dioxide fields. There are underground reservoirs full of carbon dioxide sitting underground. And so that key became clear. And then you had to move on to another part of the technology. How do you convert that into a business? And how do you bring the revenues that would be needed to pay back the loans that you'll need to build a business? And so it sort of builds on it. Builds from the hypothesis you start with.
So I'll try to give you an understanding of the sort of what happens internally. So I get bored quickly, and that helps me because if I'm not interested in the subject personally, I'm not going to have that juice, right? So it begins with a conversation or an unanswered question, and then I keep digging in. And if I don't have that energy, and if I'm writing about something that's been written before, I'll either have to try to find a way to write it differently in a novel way, or I'll just jettison it, just forget it. And so it becomes almost like a song. So songs, you know, that we hear are fully formed, like, oh, of course, that's that song. But, you know, that sort of energy before it, It's an intuitive process. You kind of know.
One add to that is the way I find stuff out is by listening to sources, and my source. I try to make sure that you know, I have sources across a range of spectrum. I have people in Washington, and I have, you know, experts and people in government offices. I also try to talk to people like in real America as well. And something that, and you want to listen. You want to listen to people. You want to call people. You want to ask what's going on. What do you think is important? What am I missing? What should I be writing about? I have coffee with sources all the time. A lot of times, I think that people don't know what they know. You know, people who are, work in government agencies or especially sort of midway down the totem pole, don't necessarily realize that something that is sort of obvious and commonplace to them is extremely interesting to me and is actually, you know, a very compelling piece of news. That some of my best stories have come where I've met with someone and they want to tell me about something, or they think I want to know about something that's sort of obviously the news of the day. And then they're like two thirds of the way through the conversation. This has happened so many times. They'll be like, oh, and this other thing. Oh, what? You know, and you know, you talked about trusting your instinct or getting a whiff. I mean, some of it is just like, I've never heard that. That's amazing. I mean, that's how I found out. I was two thirds of the way through a conversation about policy with this expert this big fancy expert at an enviro group who I talk to all the time, who was like, oh yeah, and I hear that these EPA employees are calling, are calling up their senators to tell them not to confirm Pruitt. What? You know, and like they did, the person who told me that didn't think that was a big deal. And I said, well, wait a minute. I've never heard of that. Is that weird? Is it like someone in the government agency is what? So some of it is like people don't realize that they know news, and you have to trust your gut. Like the thing, like everything else that person told me that day was boring. And that was the only thing he told me that was interesting. And so that was my gauge. And then I went and, you know, asked her, no one else had heard anything about that. And then I asked some other experts and they said, no, I've never heard of that. But a lot of it is just like talking to a wide range of people who maybe aren't necessarily the people who are giving you your news of the day, and just kind of trusting your own gut of like, what's that? And recognizing that people don't always know how valuable what they have to say really is.
Excellent. So one other question over here, and then after that we'll open it up to professional journalists and students. Anybody in the room?
Hi, this question is particularly for Akshat and Tony. I'm in the science program here in the MA, and struggling a little bit with framing science reporting to a general audience. When it comes to striking a balance between the science and kind of telling the science true in a way that a scientist would say, oh, that is the case, and telling a narrative story, something that will capture the public imagination? How did you kind of walk that line when you were actually writing, kind of physically writing these stories?
Yeah, so my audience is a general audience, and so I really have to try hard to find entry points and narrative vehicles to tell a story, and especially if it's a more of a narrative piece. I just did a big project about the Gulf Stream, for instance, and the Gulf Stream, as you may or may not know, it may be slowing because of climate change. That has huge implications for sea rise and climate. But my audience probably wouldn't read that story if I wrote it. So I ended up using a historical story of a submarine that NASA put together in 1969, and they drifted for 30 days in the Gulf Stream, completely sealed like a spaceship. And it was a narrative vehicle that had really been lost to history. And I used that to help structure a longer piece about the Gulf Stream and its slowing. It was very well received because it wasn't hitting people over the head with the science. It was kind of an odd angle to hit it. So I think that's really important to do that kind of out-of-the-box type of approach. Keep it simple. Shorten your sentences. I was mentioned to a Kristen grad student here. She said, "So I'm wrestling with how to write stories, science stories." And I said, when you finish with a piece, take your story, go sentence by sentence, and cut your sentences in two. That helps."
For me, the challenge was actually the opposite. I come from the world of doing science journalism, and having been a science student, if I found something scientifically interesting through a mid-level experts, I would know that readers would find it interesting. So that was a good lens. While writing this series, the problem was the opposite. The topics were actually boring. I wrote about cement. Who is interested in cement? But it's trying to add a narrative to it. And here's a stat which an academic put out, which is in between 2011 and 2014, China produced and used as much cement as the U.S. did in the whole of the 20th century. And that, to me, was, okay, so this material that's so boring is currently putting out all these emissions, because in producing every kilogram of cement, you're putting out at least a kilogram of carbon dioxide into the air. And we are using somewhere around 3 billion tons of cement every year. And so if this material that made society is also destroying it, how can we fix it? So that's sort of trying to find that narrative through talking to lots of people and finding this interesting thing and then converting that into a longer story. That was one of the tricks.
Also, scientists are really tough to talk to. I would sit there and talk to an oceanographer and just for 3 hours, and my head would explode. They're not speaking English. And so our job really is to translate that. But we got to keep in mind, we have to translate. We can't copy them. We have to simplify and be fearless about simplifying it. And don't be afraid to use a simple metaphor, and because it, even if the scientists would, you can see them shaking their head. No, it means this. It means that. There's a billion caveats. So they always talk in caveats. Just simplify it. You're doing the Lord's work that way.
I would counter that. I love talking to scientists. I love talking to scientists. They are the most, they'll speak to you what they really think. When you talk to corporations, they'll tell you, they'll have a marketing line to put out. Academics usually don't have that. They are true to what they've seen and the data they've. Yes, it's tough to always understand what they're talking about, and so you need to push them, but they're also genuinely nice people.
You're lucky you're a scientist, because that helps. No, and I agree. Scientists are superheroes today. You know, what they are doing is so important, and if they aren't heard, we're screwed.
I just would add that, like, everything we write about is essentially can be a narrative. I mean, narratives take more space because they require color, and context, and they're not just the facts of the news. I mean, so then you need to have the commitment of the institution to allow you to tell it narratively. But you know, every interview you do can become a narrative. It's just a question of the backup that you have to tell it narratively. And so anything scientifically complicated can be told narratively. There's always a story there of how that science, you know, the people involved behind it and the making of that science and the project involved there's a core of a story that is sitting there waiting to be told. You just have to have the luxury to be able to tell it that way. And I think that's the best way to tell it. Because you can communicate science, you can communicate incredibly complicated things narratively, and that's what readers want to read. Is they want to read a narrative. They will not read the scientific story in the same way that they would read it narratively, but they could be just as well informed through a narrative, and they would understand the science narratively.
All right, let's have one more question from the audience, and then we'll wrap up with some final remarks from our panelists. Yes.
So just on the sources topic, especially for Eric and Coral, but for the whole panel, so you guys don't have an agenda, but increasingly people don't understand that. For you guys, for your industry sources, I'm wondering how you hold on to people who might not trust journalism right now, who might not trust what you're trying to do, and especially people who maybe are seeing their agenda carried out in federal agencies, who might be less willing to talk to you than they were in the past. And in general, how do you balance an increasing distrust in journalism when you're actually sourcing some of these stories?
So I think the people who trust us the least are not so much people who work in industry than, I don't know, sort of a core of people who have this idea that what we do is make stuff up. I don't think industry sources think that we're making things up. I've been on this beat for a long time, so I've been covering people in the fossil fuel industry and the electric utility industry for years, and so I have relationships with them. I know them. They know me. And I would also say that by straight industry sources also are not going to say that science isn't real. Say that, you know, established scientific facts aren't real. They might be advancing an agenda, and they're going to try to, you know, give spin or that advances the agenda. But I think by and large, if we're clear and straightforward and reporting facts and making, you know, calling the industry and making sure, you know, we want to, and a lot of times, I mean, with the coal industry, I'll say I want to, like, In the Obama administration, I wrote a lot of stories where I said, look, these regulations probably are going to hurt your industry and put coal miners out of work and depress these towns. Talk to me about that. I want that voice in. On the other hand, I one time speak like it's like all about leaked emails. I got a coal. I was trying to get a comment from a major coal company, and I had been emailing back and forth with their lobbyists and their flacks and all these people. And someone sent a response to me that had a series of exchanges that I clearly was not supposed to see, because the lobbyist who I'd been trying to get comment from had written all this stuff about me. I had asked these very basic questions. They said, did you see these questions? She's obviously very stupid. Which is fine. The questions were very, very simple, because sometimes you have to ask simple questions that make you seem stupid in order to get good answers, which is fine. So, but she said that she's obviously very stupid. And she's also like pro enviro, like look at her stories. You can tell. So that was illuminating to me. That they thought that at the end, though, they still worked with me, gave me an interview, gave me quotes. You know, I still kind of had a relationship. And the person who wrote that ended up retiring. So that was sort of like, all right, well, now I, you know, okay, that's what they think of me. But I'm
I'm still going to ask the questions I'm going to ask, and I think a way to make sure that industry works with you is make sure you always let them know what you're writing and reach out to them and say, like, I'm writing a story that says, you know, according to this, like, you kill babies every year, which is a real story that we've written. You know, please respond. I want, you know, tell me why, you know, give me your side, or tell me why, you know, you have to do what you're doing. Like, we, and also, just so you know, you can go and tell your bosses that this is what the story is going to say.
Well, I think we've had some really great, I'm looking at the clock, Eric, I'm sorry. I think we've had some terrific conversation here tonight. There were some wonderful questions. I'm really pleased by the range and the depth of the questions from the Columbia students. Great job to all of you. The future is in good hands, apparently. And I think we've had some really illuminating discussion here that shed some light on the reporting process and the life of a journalist that I think is ill understood by many people that are in our audience. So I think it's really important that we share this kind of information. I think that the Oaks Award provides a terrific platform for not only recognizing you who are doing this great work, but also for increasing public understanding of our profession. So I do have one last kind of lightning round question for all of you. But before I do that, I'm going to take a moment to do an approved public service announcement. If you're interested in environmental journalism, the National Conference of the Society of Environmental Journalists is happening in a couple of weeks, October 3 through 7, and this year we are in Flint, Michigan, a terrific place for 500 to 700 people to gather and talk about environmental journalism. And looking at the students in the room, I want to particularly note that our full conference registration fee for students is $90. And the one-day conference registration fee is $30. This includes most of your meals. So obviously, it's a loss on the part of this professional society, but a statement of support for students in the future of environmental journalism. And we have several, I would say at least half a dozen people in this room, including some on this panel, also speaking at our conference. So if you liked this, please come check out for more. So now my lightning round question for all of you is, why do you do this work of environmental journalism?
I just first for a minute, just want to say to Hiroko Tabuchi and Barry Meyer and Danielle Ivory, who also were part of our team that did stories, that the work we all did together, and just to recognize their work. And Hiroko and I did a story out of Wyoming about Devon Energy and how the Pruitt administration was doing so many favors for a company that had helped raise his stature. And Barry and I did a story out of Montana about the coal industry. And Danielle built a database of EPA enforcement, which no one else had built, that showed the decline in EPA enforcement. I just want to recognize their great work that is part of our team as well. And I mean, I think that what's happening on the regulatory side of the House in the Trump administration is so important, and we as an American society are so fixated with the Mueller investigation and the Russia intervention in the 2016 elections, which is enormously important and historically consequential, but that the things that it really affect every single person in the United States is you know, the methane chloride that is in the paint thinner that you can buy at your Home Depot and that is killing people and dozens of people in the United States, and the regulatory decisions that the EPA is making over chemicals and air pollution and water pollution is things that are consequential for us and for our children, and that we need to understand the justifications for those decisions. And I find that we just have this incredible place as reporters to explain that to society, and it's something that drives me as a person to really help people understand that.
So I'm going to go bigger.
my focus in environmental journalism is usually climate change and global warming. I think this is the most important story of the century of our time. The way that we power our economy is fundamentally changing the planet that humans live on permanently, forever. We are alive. We are watching that change happen. It is possible to keep that change from being completely catastrophic, and we are in the moment where where policy and the economy can change to prevent the worst of those future disasters, or to keep the planet from changing in a drastic way that could mean that humans won't be able to live on it. We're at the moment where that difference can happen. So I find this to be the most important story in the world. And I'm a new mom, and so I thought this was the most important story in the world. And since I became a mother a year ago, the dimension about how I feel about that has changed even more. It's the most important story of the world. It's the most important story of our time.
I'd say that beyond that, it's also a very depressing story. It's a very depressing story as an environmental journalist to do this day in and day out and look at people suffering and look at the world suffering. So in some way, the reason I do this is to look at what technology and policy can bring through what would be the solution to solving this problem. And so sort of a solutions-oriented approach, which keeps me an optimist rather than get depressed by how bad things are going to become.
There was a story last year about the worst jobs in America. And down at the very bottom of the list, below logger, below bug exterminator, was very bottom of the list was newspaper reporter. And yet, you know, so job security is not so great for many people. Fortunately, the Post and Courier in Charleston is an exception. The pay is terrible. That's not an exception in Charleston. But you get this amazing passport to learn about things you'd never learn about, like scum, like plankton. And then you get these awakenings as you learn about these subjects, and then you get to share them with others. Yeah. What's better than that?
I agree. So thank you for doing the work you're doing. I know that it's oftentimes we hear about we talk about the heroism of journalists who are out covering war. But I would say that especially in these times, the work that you are doing as environmental journalists, holding the government accountable is a similar act of heroism. Certainly there's a lot of personal sacrifice and time involved far beyond the amount that is accounted for on your paychecks. So thank you all for the great work you're doing, and congratulations.